Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Second Book of General Ignorance, Everything You Think You Know Is Still Wrong, by John Lloyd and John Mitchinson. Narrated by Julian Elfer. Forethought, Stephen Fry. Now what I want is facts. Teach these boys and girls nothing but facts. Facts alone are wanted in life. Plant nothing else, and root out everything else. You can only form the minds of reasoning animals upon facts. Nothing else will ever be of any service to them. This is the principle on which I bring up my own children, and this is the principle on which I bring up these children. Stick to facts, sir. Nothing but a shudder runs up the spine of the sensible man, woman, or child as they read these well-known words of Thomas Gradgrind in Dickens's novel Hard Times. But surely, Stephen, you say in that way of yours, QI and general ignorance and all that they are or hope to be represent nothing more than the triumphant distillation of Gradgrindery, fact dweebiness, trivia hoarding and information hugging. The world of noble ideas falls before your world of grinding facts. Facts are the abrasive touchstones on which we test the validity of concepts. Surely, Stephen, surely, surely, surely. I'm right, aren't I? Aren't I? Oh, do say I am. Well now, bless you and shush, and oh, you dear things, calm yourselves and sit down in a semicircle on the playmat while we think about this. I know it must seem sometimes that QI is a nerd's charter that encourages boring dorks to vomit undigested boluses of fibrous factoid. QI and its volumes of general ignorance might appear to some to be nothing more than provisioners of ammunition for tiresome gainsaying did-you-knowers and tedious trotters out of turgid trivia. But look beneath the surface, and I hope you'll agree that the volume that you hold in your delicate hands is in truth a celebration of the greatest human quality there is, curiosity. Curiosity has wrongly, by those with a vested interest in ignorance and their own revealed truths, been traduced and eternally characterized as a dangerous felicide. But you, dearest of dear, dear listeners, know that curiosity lights the way to glory. Let us put it another way. The lack of curiosity is the dementor that sucks all hope, joy, possibility, and beauty out of the world. The dull, torpid acedia that does not care to find out, that has no hunger and thirst for input, understanding, and connection, will desertify the human landscape and land our descendants squarely in the soup. Do we want our species to make its way, foreheads thrust out, knuckles grazing the ground, into a barren of tedium and brutish, unquestioning blindness, or do we want to skip through the world filled with wonder, curiosity, and an appetite for discovery? This screamingly overwrought preface that is even now embarrassing you to the encrimsoning roots of your scalp is called Forethought in honor of Prometheus, the greatest of the titans of Greek mythology. Prometheus, whose brother Atlas was busy holding up the heavens, looked at us poor newly made humans and loved us and felt sorry that we were animals so close to gods yet still lacking something. Prometheus climbed up Olympus and stole that something from the gods, bringing it down carefully preserved in a fennel stalk. It was fire. Fire that gave us technology, but more than that, it was Iskra, the spark, the divine fire, the quality that drove us to know, the fire that allowed us to rise up on a level with the gods. The Greeks rightly understood that if there were such creatures as gods, they were, it is self-evident, capricious, inconsistent, unjust, jealous, and mean. And indeed Zeus, their king, was outraged that Prometheus, one of their own, had given humans great creating fire. He punished the Titan by chaining him to the Caucasus Mountains. Every day an eagle, or vultures depending on your source, came to peck out his liver, which, Prometheus being an immortal, grew back each night. This eternal torture he underwent for humans that we might, each one of us, have the divine spark, the immortal fire that drives us to ask why, who, when, what, where, and how. The name Prometheus means forethought. We can repay him his daily agony by being, every day, curious, wandering and entirely on fire. I adore you widely. Second Thoughts. John Lloyd and John Mitchinson. When we compiled the original book of general ignorance in 2006, aided by the doughty and indefatigable QI elves, we laboured under the misconception that we might have mined the mountain of ignorance to exhaustion, depleting its resources forever. Nothing could be further from the truth. 6 years on, 6 series later, there is so much more ignorance available that we've had to deliberately cull it in order to make this second book of general ignorance tolerably portable. We hope you'll have as much fun listening to it as we've had putting it together. It is a wonderful thing that we, the two Johnnies, aged 63 and 51 respectively, can honestly say that we genuinely do learn something new every day. Thank you for allowing us to do that. Everybody is ignorant only on different subjects. Will Rogers, 1879 to 1935. Who made the first flight in an aeroplane? We don't know his name, but he beat the Wright brothers to it by 50 years. He worked for Sir George Cayley, 1773 to 1857, an aristocratic Yorkshireman and pioneer of aeronautics, who carried out the first truly scientific study of how birds fly. Cayley correctly described the principles of lift, drag and thrust that govern flight, and this led him to build a series of prototype flying machines. His early attempts with flapping wings, powered by steam and gunpowder engines, failed, so he turned his attention to gliders instead. In 1804, he demonstrated the world's first model glider and 5 years later tested a full-sized version, but without a pilot. More than 3 decades passed before he finally felt ready to trust his governable parachute with a human passenger. In 1853, at Brompton Dale near Scarborough, the intrepid baronet persuaded his reluctant coachman to steer the contraption across the valley. It was this anonymous employee who became the first human ever to fly in a heavier-than-air machine. The coachman, so the story goes, was not impressed. He handed in his notice as soon as he landed, saying, "I was hired to drive, not to fly." A modern replica of Cayley's glider, now on show at the Yorkshire Air Museum, successfully repeated the flight across Brompton Dale in 1974. But wings weren't Sir George's only legacy. With his work on the glider's landing gear, he literally reinvented the wheel. Needing something light but strong to absorb the aircraft's impact on landing, he came up with the idea of using wheels whose spokes were held at tension rather than being carved from solid wood. These went on to transform the development of the bicycle and the car and are still widely used today. And that wasn't all. Cayley was a remarkably prolific inventor, developing self-righting lifeboats, caterpillar tracks for bulldozers, automatic signals for railway crossings, and seatbelts. Even more remarkably, he offered all these inventions for the public good without expecting any financial reward. The Wright brothers made their famous flights half a century later in 1903. They were inspired by Cayley and by another unsung hero of aviation, Otto Lilienthal, 1848-96. A Prussian known as the Glider King. He was the first person to fly consistently. In the decade before the Wright brothers, he made over 2,000 glider flights before falling to his death in 1896. His last words were humble and poignant. Small sacrifices must be made. Stephen, who invented the aeroplane? Rich Hall, it's Orville and Wilbur Wright. Claxon, the Wright brothers. Peter Serafinowicz, is it the wrong brothers? How many legs does an octopus have? 2. Octopuses have 8 limbs protruding from their bodies, but recent research into how they use them has redefined what they should be called. Octopuses, from the Greek for 8 feet, are cephalopods, Greek for head foot. They use their back 2 tentacles to propel themselves along the seabed, leaving the remaining 6 to be used for feeding. As a result, marine biologists now tend to refer to them as animals with 2 legs and 6 arms. An octopus's tentacles are miraculous organs. They can stiffen to create a temporary elbow joint or fold up to disguise their owner as a coconut rolling along the seafloor. They also contain 2/3 of the octopus's brain, about 50 million neurons, the remaining 1/3 of which is shaped like a donut and located inside its head or mantle. Because so much of an octopus's nervous system is in its extremities, each limb has a high degree of independence. A severed tentacle can continue to crawl around and, in some species, will live for several months. An octopus's arm, or leg, quite genuinely has a mind of its own. Each arm on an octopus has two rows of suckers equipped with taste buds for identifying food. An octopus tastes everything that it touches. Male octopuses also have a specialized arm in which they keep their sperm. It's called the hectocotylus and is used for mating. To transfer the sperm, the male puts his arm into a hole in the female's head. During copulation, the hectocotylus usually breaks off, but the male grows a new one the following year. The way octopuses mate was first described by Aristotle, 384 to 322 BC, but for over 2,000 years, no one believed him. The French zoologist Georges Cuvier, 1769 to 1832, rediscovered the process in the 19th century and gave the hectocotylus its name. It means 100 tiny cups in Greek. Genetic variations sometimes cause octopuses to grow more than 8 limbs. In 1998, the Shima Marine Land Aquarium in Japan had a common octopus on display that had 96 tentacles. It was captured in nearby Matoya Bay in December 1998, but died 5 months later. The multi-armed cephalopod managed to lay a batch of eggs before its death. All the offspring hatched with the normal number of arms and legs, but none survived longer than a month. Octopuses occasionally eat their own arms. This used to be blamed on stress, but is now thought to be caused by a virus that attacks their nervous system. Mira Sile, do you know how octopuses mate? Stephen, tell, tell. Alan, with difficulty. Mira, they mate with their third right arm. Alan, do they? Mira, yes. Clive Anderson, we all do that. What colour are oranges? That depends. In many countries, oranges are green, even when ripe, and are sold that way in the shops. The same goes for lemons, mangoes, tangerines, and grapefruit. Oranges are unknown in the wild. They are a cross between tangerines and the pomelo, or Chinese grapefruit, which is pale green or yellow, and were first grown in Southeast Asia. They were green there then, and today they still are. Vietnamese oranges and Thai tangerines are bright green on the outside and only orange on the inside. Oranges are subtropical fruit, not tropical ones. The color of an orange depends on where it grows. In more temperate climes, its green skin turns orange when the weather cools. But in countries where it's always hot, the chlorophyll is not destroyed and the fruits stay green. Oranges in Honduras, for example, are eaten green at home but artificially oranged for export. To achieve this, they are blasted with ethylene gas, a byproduct of the oil industry, whose main use is in the manufacture of plastic. Ethylene is the most widely produced organic compound in the world. 100 million tons of it are made every year. It removes the natural outer green layer of an orange, allowing the more familiar color to show through. Far and away, the world's largest producer of oranges is Brazil, 18 million tons a year, followed by the USA, which grows fewer than half as many. American oranges come from California, Texas, and Florida. They were often synthetically dyed until the Food and Drug Administration banned the practice in 1955. You can't tell the ripeness of an orange by its color, no matter where it's from. If an orange goes unpicked, it can stay on the tree till the next season, during which time fluctuations in temperature can make it turn from green to orange and back to green again, without the quality or flavor being affected. The oranges you see on display in your supermarket certainly appear to be completely orange, but you may now start to worry they've been gassed. Don't. Ethylene is odorless, tasteless, and harmless, and many fruits and vegetables give it off naturally after they're picked. Ethylene producers include apples, melons, tomatoes, avocados, and bananas. The gas isn't bad for you, but it can affect other kinds of fruit and veg, which is why you should keep apples and bananas separate from, say, lemons or carrots, and of course oranges. Ethylene has other uses apart from making plastics and detergents and antifreeze and altering the color of an orange. If you want to speed up the ripening process of an unripe mango, keep it in a bag with a banana. What's the name of the most southerly point of Africa? It's not the Cape of Good Hope. The residents of nearby Cape Town often have to explain this to visitors. The southernmost point of the continent is the altogether less famous Cape Agulhas, 150 kilometres, 93 miles, southeast of the Cape of Good Hope. The usual reason given for the Cape of Good Hope's fame and its name is that it was the psychologically important point where sailors, on the long haul down the west coast of Africa on their way to the Far East, at last began to sail in an easterly rather than a southerly direction. On the other hand, it might have been an early example of marketing spin. Bartolomeu Dias, 1451 to 1500, the Portuguese navigator who discovered the Cape of Good Hope and became the first European to make the hair-raising trip around the foot of Africa, named it Cabo das Tormentas, Cape of Storms. His employer, King John II of Portugal, 1455 to 95, keen to encourage others to adopt the new trade route, overruled him and tactfully rechristened it Cabo da Boa Esperança, Cape of Good Hope. The king died childless, aged only 40. 5 years later, Bartolomeu Dias also died. He was wrecked in a terrible storm, along with four ships and the loss of all hands, off the very cape he had so presciently named. Cape Agulhas is equally treacherous. It is Portuguese for Cape of Needles, after the sharp rocks and reefs that infest its roaring waters. The local town is home to a shipwreck museum that commemorates a graveyard of ships. Because of its isolation and rocky, inaccessible beach, the area is rich in wildlife. On land, it is home to the critically endangered microfrog, Micro Batrachella capensis, and the Agulhas clapper, Mirafra apiata majoriae, a lark whose mating display involves much noisy wing flapping. In the waters offshore between May and August, the sea boils with billions of migrating South African pilchards, Sardinops sagax. These shoals form one of the largest congregations of wildlife on the planet, equivalent to the great wildebeest migrations on land, and can stretch to be 6 kilometres, 3.7 miles long, and 2 kilometres, 1.2 miles wide. Hundreds of thousands of sharks, dolphins, seals, and seabirds travel in the fish's wake, snacking on them at will, but making little impact on the overall numbers. Cape Agulhas is at 34 degrees, 49 minutes, 58 seconds south, and 20 degrees, 0 seconds, 12 minutes east, and it is the official dividing point between the Atlantic and Indian Oceans. If you sailed past it along the relatively unimpressive, gradually curving coastline, you probably wouldn't even notice it, but for the cairn that marks the tip's exact location. What's the hardest known substance? It's not diamonds anymore. In 2005, scientists at Bayreuth University in Germany created a new material by compressing pure carbon under extreme heat. It's called hyperdiamond or aggregated diamond nanorods, ADNR, and although it's incredibly hard, it looks rather like asphalt or a glittery black pudding. It's long been known that one form of pure carbon, graphite, can be turned into another, diamond, by heat and pressure. But the Bayreuth team used neither. They used a third form of pure carbon, fullerite, also known as Buckminster fullerene or buckyballs. Its 60 carbon atoms form a molecule shaped like a soccer ball or like one of the geodesic domes invented by the American architect Richard Buckminster Fuller, 1895 to 1983. The carbon atoms in diamond are arranged in cubes stacked in pyramids. The new substance is made of tiny interlocking rods. These are called nanorods because they are so small. Nanos is Greek for dwarf. Each is 1 micron, 1 millionth of a meter long, and 20 nanometers, 20 billionths of a meter wide, about 1/50,000th of the width of a human hair. Subjecting fullerite to extremes of heat, 2,220 degrees centigrade, and compression, 200,000 times normal atmospheric pressure, created not only the hardest, but also the stiffest and densest substance known to science. Density is how tightly packed a material's molecules are and is measured by using X-rays. ADNR is 0.3% denser than diamond. Stiffness is a measure of compressibility, the amount of force that must be applied equally on all sides to make the material shrink in volume. Its basic unit is the Pascal, after Blaise Pascal, 1623 to 62, the French mathematician who helped develop the barometer, which measures air pressure. ADNR's stiffness rating is 491 gigapascals, GPA. Diamonds is 442 GPA, and iron's is 180 GPA. This means that ADNR is almost 3 times harder to compress than iron. Hardness is simpler to determine. If one material can make a scratch mark on another, it's harder. The German mineralogist Friedrich Mohs, 1773 to 1839, devised the Mohs hardness scale in 1812. It starts at the softest end with talc, MH1. Lead is fairly soft at MH1.5. Fingernails are graded MH2.5, as hard as gold. In the middle are glass and knife blades at MH5.5. Ordinary sandpaper, which is made of corundum, is MH9, and right at the top end is diamond at MH10. Since ADNR can scratch diamond, it is literally off the scale. And there's more disappointing news for diamond fans. They aren't forever. Graphite, which oddly enough is one of the softest known substances, as soft as talc, is much more chemically stable than diamond. In fact, all diamonds are very slowly turning into graphite, but the process is imperceptible. There's no danger of anybody suddenly finding their earrings have become pencils. What's the strangest substance known to science? H2O. Water, or hydrogen oxide, is the strangest substance known to science. With the possible exception of air, it's also the most familiar. It covers 70% of the Earth and accounts for 70% of our own brains. Water is oxygen linked to hydrogen, the simplest and most common element in the universe, in the simplest way possible. Any other gas combined with hydrogen just produces another gas. Only oxygen and hydrogen make a liquid. And it's a liquid that behaves so differently from any other that theoretically it shouldn't exist. There are 66 known ways in which water is abnormal, the most peculiar being that nothing else in nature is found simultaneously as liquid, solid, and gas. A sea full of icebergs under a cloudy sky may appear natural, but in chemical terms it is anything but. Most substances shrink as they cool, but when water falls below 4 degrees centigrade, it starts to expand and become lighter. That's why ice floats and why wine bottles burst if left in the freezer. Each water molecule can attach itself to 4 other water molecules. Because water is so strongly bonded, a lot of energy is needed to change it from one state to another. It takes 10 times more energy to heat water than iron. Because water can absorb a lot of heat without getting hot, it helps keep the planet's climate steady. Temperatures in the oceans are 3 times more stable than on land, and water's transparency allows light to penetrate its depths, enabling life in the sea. Without water, there would be no life at all, and, though you can put your hand right through it, it's remarkably difficult to compress, and water heat at speed is as hard as concrete. Although the bonds between water molecules are strong, they aren't stable. They are constantly being broken and remade. Each molecule of water collides with other water molecules 10 quadrillion times a second. So many things can be dissolved in water that it's known as the universal solvent. If you dissolve metal in acid, it's gone forever. If you dissolve plaster in water, when all the water is evaporated, the plaster is still there. This ability to dissolve stuff without eradicating it also paradoxically makes water the most destructive substance on the planet. Sooner or later, it eats away everything, from an iron drainpipe to the Grand Canyon. And it gets everywhere. There are substantial deposits of ice on the moon and on Mars. Traces of water vapor have even been detected on the cooler patches of the sun's surface. On Earth, only a tiny fraction of all the water is in the atmosphere. If it fell evenly throughout the world, it would produce no more than 25 millimeters or an inch of rain. Most of Earth's water is inaccessible, locked deep inside the planet, carried down when tectonic plates overlap, or held inside the mineral structure of the rocks themselves. If this hidden water were released, it would refill the oceans 30 times over. At what temperature does water freeze? Pure water doesn't freeze at 0 degrees centigrade, nor does seawater. For water to freeze, it needs something for its molecules to latch onto. Ice crystals form around nuclei, such as small particles of dust. If there are none of these, you can get the temperature of water down to minus 42 degrees centigrade before it freezes. Cooling water without freezing it is known as supercooling. It has to be done slowly. You can put a bottle of very pure water in your freezer and supercool it. When you take the bottle out and tap it, the water will instantly turn to ice. Cooling water extremely fast has a completely different effect. It bypasses the ice stage, which has a regular crystalline lattice structure, and transforms it into a chaotic amorphous solid known as glassy water, so called because the random arrangement of molecules is similar to that found in glass. To form glassy water, you need to get the water temperature down to minus 137 degrees centigrade in a few milliseconds. You won't find glassy water outside the lab on Earth, but it's the most common form of water in the universe. It's what comets are made of. Because of its high salt content, seawater regularly falls below 0 degrees centigrade without freezing. The blood of fishes normally freezes at about minus 0.5 degrees centigrade, so marine biologists used to be puzzled by how fish survived in polar oceans. It turns out that species like Antarctic ice fish and herring produce proteins in the pancreas that are absorbed into their blood. These prevent the formation of ice nuclei, much like antifreeze in a car radiator. Given the peculiarities of water at low temperatures, it won't surprise you to learn that the boiling point of water, even at normal pressure, isn't necessarily 100 degrees centigrade either. It can be much more. Again, the liquid needs to be warmed slowly and in a container that has no scratches. It is these that contain the small pockets of air around which the first bubbles form. Boiling happens when bubbles of water vapor expand and break the surface. For this to happen, the temperature must be high enough for the pressure created by the vapor bubble to exceed the atmospheric pressure. Under normal conditions, this is 100 degrees centigrade, but if the water is free of places where bubbles could form, more heat is needed to overcome the surface tension of the bubbles as they struggle into life. It's the same reason that blowing up a balloon is always harder at the beginning. This explains why a boiling hot cup of coffee in the microwave can explode all over you once removed or stirred. The movement sets off a chain reaction so that all the water in the coffee vaporizes at high speed. One last watery oddity. Hot water freezes faster than cold water. Aristotle first noted this in the 4th century BC, but it was only accepted by modern science in 1963. This resulted from the persistence of a Tanzanian schoolboy called Erasto Mpemba, who proved it by repeatedly demonstrating that a hot ice cream mixture set more quickly than cold. We still don't know why it does. Where is the largest known lake? It's 842 million miles away, halfway across the solar system. In 2007, the Cassini-Huygens space probe sent back pictures of Titan, the largest of Saturn's moons. Near the moon's northern pole, radar imaging revealed a giant lake estimated to cover 388,500 square kilometers, 150,000 square miles, significantly bigger than the Caspian Sea, the largest lake on Earth, at 370,400 square kilometers, 143,244 square miles. The lake is called Kraken Mare. Mare is Latin for sea, and the kraken is a sea monster from Norse mythology. Titan has many lakes, and they are the only bodies of stable liquid known to exist anywhere other than on Earth. But the liquid isn't water. Titan's average temperature is minus 181 degrees centigrade, so any water would be frozen solid. They are lakes of liquid gas, methane and ethane, the main ingredients of natural gas on Earth, and they are so cold that they may even contain frozen methane bergs. Titan's chemical composition is thought to be very similar to that of Earth during the period when life first appeared here, and it is the only moon in the solar system with an atmosphere. In 2004, Ladbrokes, the bookmaker, in a joint publicity stunt with New Scientist magazine, offered odds of 10,000 to 1 against life being discovered on Titan. Would this be worth risking a Titan on? A Titan is the 100 million pound note used by the Bank of England for interbank accounting purposes. On balance, probably not. The development of DNA on Titan is unlikely because of the extreme cold and the lack of liquid water. However, some astrobiologists have suggested that Titan's hydrocarbon lakes might sustain forms of life that would inhale hydrogen in place of oxygen. Another theory is that life could have reached Titan from Earth through microbes clinging to rocks smashed out of Earth's orbit by asteroid impacts. This theory is called panspermia, from pan, all, and sperma, seed in Greek, and was used to explain the presence of life on Earth as long ago as the 5th century BC, when the Greek cosmologist Anaxagoras first proposed it. What is certain is that as the sun gets hotter, the temperature on Titan will also rise, making the conditions for life more likely. Whether in 6 billion years or so Ladbrokes will still exist to pay out any winnings is much less probable. The Cassini-Huygens probe is named after the Italian astronomer Giovanni Domenico Cassini, 1625 to 1712, who discovered four of Saturn's smaller moons between 1671 and 1684, and the Dutch polymath Christian Huygens, 1629 to 95, who discovered Titan in 1654. Among Huygens' other achievements were working out the theory of centrifugal force, publishing a book on the use of probability in dice games, building the first pendulum clock, and writing the first ever physics equation. Where is the world's saltiest water? Not in the Dead Sea. The saltiest water in the world is found in Don Juan Pond in the dry valleys of northeastern Antarctica. Also known as Lake Don Juan, it's really more of a puddle with an average depth of less than 15 centimeters, 6 inches. Its water is so salty that it doesn't freeze despite the surrounding air temperature of minus 50 degrees centigrade. The water is 40% salt, 18 times saltier than seawater, and more than twice as salty as the Dead Sea, which is only 8 times saltier than the oceans. Don Juan Pond was discovered by accident in 1961 and named after two US Navy helicopter pilots, Lieutenants Donald Rowe and John Hickey, hence Don John or Don Juan in Spanish, who carried in the first field party to study it. It's probably the most interesting puddle on Earth. Given the Antarctica's dry valleys are the driest, coldest places on the planet, it's astonishing that there's water there at all. It didn't come from the sky, it's too cold and windy there for rain or snow. It seeped up from the ground, slowly becoming saltier as the top layer of water evaporated. In spite of these unpromising conditions, the first researchers were amazed to discover it contained life. Slender mats of blue-green algae that harbored a flourishing community of bacteria, yeast and fungi. Since that first expedition, for reasons that are unclear, the water level in the pond has more than halved and no life remains. But even this is significant because its waters still contain nitrous oxide, better known as laughing gas, a chemical previously believed to require organic life to produce it. This has now been shown to be a byproduct of the reaction between the salts in the pond and the volcanic basalt rock that surrounds it. If liquid water is found on Mars, it is likely to be in the form of cold, briny pools, just like Don Juan Pond, and we now know that at least some of the nitrogen-rich chemicals needed to produce life can occur in even the harshest environment. Unlike Don Juan Pond, there is still plenty of life in the Dead Sea. There are no fish, but it's teeming with algae. This supports microbes that feed on it called halobacteria. They belong to the Archaea domain, the oldest life forms on the planet. Archaea are so ancient that on the evolutionary timescale, human beings are closer to bacteria than bacteria are to archaea. Like the former inhabitants of Don Juan Pond, halobacteria are extremophiles, surviving in conditions once believed impossible for life. The halobacterium is also known as the Renaissance bug because it can mend its own DNA, which is damaged by high salt concentrations. If this can be harnessed, it could be of great benefit to cancer sufferers. It might even enable manned spaceflight to Mars by helping astronauts protect their DNA from exposure to the fierce radiation of interplanetary space. Where did most minerals in the world come from? Life on Earth. There are about 4,300 minerals in the world today, but in the primordial dust that was to become the solar system, there were fewer than a dozen. All the chemical elements were already there, but minerals were very rare before the sun and the planets formed. Unlike all the other planets, Earth's crust is a patchwork of constantly moving tectonic plates. Tectonic is from the Greek word for construction. No one knows why, but one theory is that all the water on the Earth's surface caused cracks in it, like damp from a flooded bathroom seeping through a plaster ceiling. As the plates of the young Earth jostled together, they created immense heat and pressure, pushing the number of minerals up to perhaps 1,000. Then, 4 billion years ago, life appeared. Microscopic algae began using sunlight to convert the carbon dioxide that made up most of the atmosphere into carbohydrates for food. This released oxygen as a byproduct. Oxygen is both the most abundant and the most reactive element in the planet's crust. It forms compounds with almost anything. As it bonded with silicon, copper, and iron, hundreds of new minerals were created. Although we think of oxygen as a gas, almost half the rocks on Earth are made from it. While oxygen was being released into the atmosphere, carbon was also being sucked into the sea. Carbon, the basis of life, is as stable as oxygen is reactive. Its stability has made it the core of millions of organic compounds, including all the proteins, fats, acids, and carbohydrates that go to make up living things. As the complexity of life on Earth increased, new minerals were created. Marine creatures died and drifted to the seabed, the thick layers of their shells and skeletons destined to become limestone, chalk, and marble. Meanwhile, over millions of years, the sludge of rotting plants provided the ingredients for coal and oil. More life and more diversity of life meant more minerals. Two-thirds of all the minerals on Earth were once alive. This parallel evolution of life and rocks gives clues to what we should look for on other planets. If certain minerals are detected, it's a good bet that they came into being alongside particular types of organism. Are we depleting the world's mineral reserves? Oil aside, none of the evidence suggests so. Although vegetables grown in the UK and the USA over the past 50 years have shown significant drops in the levels of the trace minerals they contain, this is the result of artificial fertilizers, which promote faster growth at the expense of the plant's ability to absorb nutrients from the air and soil. This may explain why people say that food tasted better during the war. They're probably right. What are trees made from? Air. Most of the material that turns a tiny seed into a mighty tree comes from the sky, not the ground. Small amounts of essential minerals come from the soil, but by far the majority of a tree's bulk is processed air. The tree's leaves convert light energy from the sun into chemical energy. This is used to recombine the carbon from carbon dioxide in the air and the hydrogen from rainwater into carbohydrates. The main one is cellulose, better known as wood. When the chemical reaction is complete, the tree releases the oxygen it doesn't need back into the air. A medium-sized tree generates about the same amount of oxygen that each one of us needs to breathe. This is the miracle of photosynthesis. Since all life depends on plants to eat, it is probably the most important biological process on Earth. Giant sequoia trees are the heaviest living things ever to have existed. They can weigh up to 6,000 tons and reach over 95 meters, 300 feet, in height, and 12 meters, 40 feet in diameter. Their bark is up to 1.5 meters, 5 feet thick, but the seeds are minuscule, weighing 0.009 gram, 1/3,000th of an ounce, each approximately 1/1,000,000th the weight of the fully grown tree. Giant sequoias are also the fastest growing trees in the world. For this, they need not just air, but fire. The trees rely on the heat of forest fires to open their tough seed cones and to expose the bare soil. So the US Forest Service deliberately sets fire to the sequoia groves on a regular basis. At the other end of the scale, the smallest trees in the world are the dwarf willows that grow on the tundra of Greenland. Fully grown, they struggle to reach 2 inches tall. In 2008, a Norway spruce, Pikea abies, found growing in Sweden, was carbon dated to an astonishing 9,555 years old, taking the prize for both the oldest living plant and the oldest living organism. Definitions of a single organism are tricky, though. There are groves of quaking aspens in Utah that have root systems thought to date back 80,000 years. If it weren't for recycling, the paper the world gets through in one day would use up 12 million trees, about 250 square kilometers of forest. How can you tell the age of a tree in a rainforest? It almost certainly won't have any rings, so don't bother trying to count them. Your best bet is probably radiocarbon dating. The living fiber of a tree's trunk is known as vascular tissue, from the Latin vasculum, meaning little vessel, because, like the blood vessels in a body, it carries the water and nutrients to the leaves and flowers. Trees in temperate climes grow in a stop-start fashion, depending on the season, and this creates the annual growth ring. Plenty of water and a long, warm season of growth will create a wide ring. Drought or frost will produce a narrow one. There is only one recorded case of British oak trees failing to create an annual ring. This was in 1816, the year of no summer, when the world's climate was plunged into crisis by the eruption of Mount Tambora in Indonesia. Counting a tree's rings and relating the number to the date, technically known as dendrochronology, is remarkably accurate for temperate species of tree. But it isn't much use in the tropics, where there is little difference between seasons and most trees have no discernible rings. In 2005, a team of Brazilian and American scientists conducted a large-scale research project to calculate the age of trees in the Amazon rainforest. They used radiocarbon dating methods similar to those employed by archaeologists when calculating the date of organic artifacts. All organic material contains traces of carbon-14, the radioactive form of carbon. This decays at a fixed rate, enabling the material's age to be calculated accurately. The results were surprising. More than half of those trees recorded with trunk diameters of as little as 10 centimeters, 4 inches, were already 300 years old, and many of the large canopy trees were 750 to 1,000 years old. This slow growth rate seems to be the result of nutrient-poor soil and the lack of light underneath the canopy. Why do trees live for so long? One of the secrets of their longevity is that, unlike most animals, they can close off diseased or damaged portions of themselves without killing the whole organism. Even cleverer, some trees defy the aging process by generating clones, or genetically identical shoots, so that even when one trunk dies, the network of roots can send out a new one. Perhaps the most famous of these is the quaking aspen, Populus tremuloides, which can form groves of several hundred trees, each of which is a limb of one vast living thing. Some of these colonies have been traced back 80,000 years. Recent evidence, however, suggests the number of male reproductive cells declines as they age, so although they are very old, they aren't immortal. Of the trees that don't use this trick, the oldest surviving example was until recently believed to be a Methuselah, a bristlecone pine in California, which is at 4,765 years old, older than Stonehenge or the pyramids. The Norway spruce, Picea abies, in the Dalarna province of Sweden, that was carbon dated as 9,555 years old, grew as it did because cold weather had stopped the roots from growing for thousands of years, so it stayed a shrub until a century ago when warmer weather encouraged it to sprout a new trunk. Called Old Tycho, after the dog owned by the geologist who discovered it, it claims the prize for both the oldest living plant and the planet's oldest living organism of any kind. Stephen, where's the best place in the world to discover an entirely new species? Alan, what about the Amazon rainforest, where they're discovering new things all the time? Claxon. Stephen, you'd have to travel thousands of miles. You'd have to park there. You'd have to look. You know. Alan, park? David Mitchell, everyone knows it's a nightmare, parking. Stephen, I'm suddenly worried that my brain let me say that. Which came first, the chicken or the egg? The egg, final answer. As the geneticist J.B.S. Haldane, 1892 to 1964, remarked, the most frequently asked question is, which came first, the chicken or the egg? The fact that it is still asked proves either that many people have never been taught the theory of evolution or that they don't believe it. With that in mind, the answer becomes obvious. Birds evolved from reptiles, so the first bird must have come out of an egg, laid by a reptile. Like everything else, an egg is not as simple as it looks. For a start, the word egg is used in two different ways. To a biologist, an egg is an ovum, Latin for egg, the tiny female reproductive cell which, when fertilized by a male sperm, Greek for seed, develops into an embryo. Both the ovum and the sperm are called gametes, from the Greek gameti, wife, and gametes, husband. In a hen's egg, these two tiny cells merge in the germinal spot, or blastodisc, from blastos, Greek for sprout. Around this is the yolk, which provides most of the nutrition for the growing chick. The word yolk comes from Old English, geolka, yellow. Until the late 19th century, it was often spelt yelk. Around the yolk is the egg white or albumen, from the Latin albus white, which is also nutritious, but whose main purpose is to protect the yolk, which is held in place in the center of the egg by two twisted threads called chalazae. Chalaza is Greek for hailstone. The knotted white cord looks like a string of minute pearls or balls of ice. Around the albumen is the shell, which is made from calcium carbonate, the same stuff that skeletons and indigestion pills are made from. It's porous so that the chick can breathe, and the air is kept in a pocket between the albumen and the shell. Membranes separate each part, and together it's known as a cladoic egg, from the Greek kleidon, meaning to lock up. A chicken makes the whole thing from scratch in a single day. Because its shell is porous, if you keep an egg for a long time, the yolk and albumen dry out, sucking air inside. That's why rotten eggs float. To find out what colour egg a hen will lay, examine her earlobes. Hens with white earlobes lay white eggs, hens with red earlobes lay brown ones. The colour of a hen's egg depends on the breed of the chicken, it has nothing to do with diet. In 1826, the Estonian biologist Karl Ernst von Baer, 1792-1876, proved that women produce eggs like other animals. Since the time of Aristotle, everyone had thought that a male's seed was planted in the woman and nurtured in the womb. The first observation of semen under a microscope by Anton von Leeuwenhoek, 1632-1723, in 1677, seemed to confirm this. He thought he had seen a miniature homunculus, or little man, in each sperm. It wasn't until the 1870s that the embryo was proven to develop from the union of egg and sperm, and it took another 20 years before German biologist August Weismann, 1832-1914, discovered that sperm and ovum carried only half the parent's genes. The sperm is one of the smallest cells in the human body. It's only a 20th the size of an ovum, whereas the ovum is one of the largest. It's 12 times bigger than the average cell, but still only the size of a full stop on this page. Can you name a fish? Don't even try, there's no such thing. After a lifetime study of the creatures formerly known as fish, the great paleontologist Stephen Jay Gould, 1941-2002, concluded they didn't exist. The point he was making is that the word fish is applied indiscriminately to entirely separate classes of animal. Cartilaginous ones, like sharks and rays, bony ones, including most fish, from piranhas and eels to seahorses and cod, and ones with skulls but no backbones or jaws, such as hagfish and lampreys. These three classes split off from one another far longer ago than the different orders, families, and genuses did from each other, so that a salmon, for example, has more in common with, and is more closely related to, a human than a hagfish. To an evolutionary biologist, fish is not a useful word unless it's on a menu. And this isn't just a quirk particular to Gould. The Oxford Encyclopedia of Underwater Life comments, "Incredible as it may sound, there is no such thing as a fish. The concept is merely a convenient umbrella term to describe an aquatic vertebrate that is not a mammal, a turtle, or anything else. It's equivalent to calling bats and flying lizards birds just because they happen to fly. The relationship between a lamprey and a shark, the encyclopedia insists, is no closer than that between a salamander and a camel. Still, it's better than it was. In the 16th century, seals, whales, crocodiles, and even hippos were called fish. And today, cuttlefish, starfish, crayfish, jellyfish, and shellfish, which by any scientific definition aren't fish at all, still are. Stephen Jay Gould made the same point about trees. The tree form has evolved many times in the course of history. Its ancestors were unrelated plants such as grasses, roses, mosses, and clovers. So for Gould, there's no such thing as a tree either. One fish that absolutely doesn't exist is the sardine. It's a generic term used for around 20 different small, soft-boned, oily fish, and only once they're in a can. In the UK, they're usually called pilchards, often called, optimistically, true sardines, although the Latin name, Sardina pilchardus, points up the confusion. Sometimes what you get in a sardine can is a herring, sometimes it's a sprat, which glories in the scientific name Spratus spratus spratus. What it isn't is a sardine, nor even, as we now know, a fish. Alan. At night, all the ugly fish come out, and it's really interesting. Stephen, you don't need to be pretty out there. Alan, that's right, you go to the Red Sea, and in the day, the fish are beautiful, colourful fish, and then at night, they're all bug-eyed, they limp around, and you're not allowed to touch them. And they all kind of look at you, and you shine a light at them, and they go, no, no, don't look at me, don't look at me. How does a shark know you're there? You don't have to be bleeding for one to track you down. Sharks have an astonishingly powerful sense of smell. They can detect blood at a concentration of one part in 25 million, the equivalent of a single drop of blood in a 9,000-litre, 2,000-gallon tank of water. It's the currents that determine the speed and direction of a smell's dispersal in water, so sharks swim into the current. If you are bleeding, even slightly, a shark will know. If the current is running at a moderate 3.5 kilometers per hour, about 2.25 miles per hour, a shark 400 meters, a quarter of a mile, downstream will smell your blood in 7 minutes. Sharks swim at nearly 40 kilometers per hour, 25 miles per hour, so one could reach you in 60 seconds. Faster currents make things worse, even allowing for the fact that the shark has more to swim against. In a riptide of 26 kilometers per hour, 16 miles per hour, a shark less than half a kilometer, a quarter of a mile downstream, would detect you in a minute and take less than 2 to reach you, giving you 3 minutes in total to escape. Sharks also see very well, but even a short-sighted shark with a bad head cold, not that it happens, would still be able to find you. Sharks have excellent hearing in the lower frequencies and can hear something thrashing about at a distance of half a kilometer, a third of a mile, so you could try being very quiet indeed. A blind, stone-deaf shark with no nose would still find you without breaking stride. Sharks' heads are riddled with jelly-filled canals by the name of ampullae of Lorenzini, after Stefano Lorenzini, the Italian doctor who first described them in 1678. We've only recently discovered what their purpose is, to register the faint electrical fields generated by all living bodies. So as long as you're not bleeding, not moving, and your brain and heart aren't working, you should be fine. And there's some more good news. Sort of. Californian oceanographer Professor Dr. Jamie McMahon has found that the standard view of a riptide is wrong. It doesn't run out to sea, but is circular like a whirlpool. If you swim parallel to the shore, he says, there's a 50% chance you'll be swept out into the ocean deeps. But if you just tread water, there's a 90% chance of being returned to shore within 3 minutes, perhaps just in time to escape the shark. If a shark does find you, try turning it upside down and tickling its tummy. It will enter a reflex state known as tonic immobility and float motionless as if hypnotized. Killer whales exploit this by flipping sharks over onto their backs and holding them immobile in the water until they suffocate. You have about 15 minutes before the shark gets wise to your ruse. Careful, though. Not all species of shark react the same way. Tiger sharks, for example, respond best to a gentle massage around the eyes. According to shark expert Michael Rutson, it's just like tickling trout. All you have to do is defend your own personal space and stay calm. Having said all this, relax. Sharks almost never attack people. Figures from all 22 U.S. coastal states, averaged over the last 50 years, show that you are 76 times more likely to be killed by a bolt of lightning than by a shark. Does the Mediterranean have tides? Yes, it does, despite what every tour guide tells you. Most of them are very small, just a few centimeters back and forth on average. This is because the Mediterranean is cut off from the Atlantic and the huge effect of the pull of the moon on it by the narrow Straits of Gibraltar. Right next door to the entrance to the Med, sea levels can change by around 80 centimeters, 3 feet. But in the Gulf of Gaweis, off the coast of eastern Tunisia, the tidal elevation can be as much as 2.5 meters, 8 feet, twice a day. This is because tides are caused not only by the gravitational effect of the moon, but also by atmospheric pressure, depth, salinity, temperature, and the shape of the coastline. The relatively big tides in the Gulf of Gabes result from its shape. It is a wide, shallow basin about 100 kilometers, 60 miles, wide by 100 kilometers long. The Gulf acts as a funnel, the tidal energy forcing water into a progressively smaller space, thereby increasing the rise in sea level and, correspondingly, lowering it on the way out. The same thing happens on a much greater scale in the Bristol Channel, which has a tidal range of over 9 meters, 30 feet. Tidal effects are at their strongest when the Sun and Moon are on the same side of the Earth, new moon, or on the opposite side, full moon, and their gravitational pulls combine to create the strong spring tides, spring in the sense of powerful forward movement, not the season. The Phoenicians founded Gabes in about 800 BC. Pliny the Elder first noted its unusually large tides in AD 77 in his Natural History. He also recorded that Gabes was second only to Tyre in the production of the expensive purple dye made from murex shells, which the Phoenicians discovered, hence the Greek for purple, phoenikeos, and which was highly prized by the Romans. The toga purpurea was worn only by kings, generals in triumph, and emperors. The Mediterranean is bigger than you might think. At 2,500 square kilometers, 965,000 square miles, it covers the same area as Sudan, the largest country in Africa, and would comfortably swallow Western Europe, France, Spain, Germany, Italy, Greece, Britain, the Netherlands, Belgium, Switzerland, and Austria combined. Its coastline stretches for 46,000 kilometers, 28,000 miles, or about twice the length of the coastline of Africa. Nor is it particularly shallow. Its average depth is over 1.5 kilometers, about a mile, while the North Sea's is a mere 94 meters, 310 feet, and at its deepest point in the Ionian Sea, it reaches down nearly 5 kilometers, over 3 miles, substantially deeper than the average depth of the Atlantic. 6 million years ago, the Mediterranean dried out completely in the so-called Messinian salinity crisis. This created the largest salt basin that ever existed and raised the sea level of the rest of the world by 10 meters, 33 feet. 300,000 years later, the rock barrier at the Straits of Gibraltar gave way in a cataclysm called the Zanclean Flood, producing the world's largest ever waterfall and refilling the whole of the Mediterranean in as little as 2 years. The tide would have risen 10 meters every day, but it wouldn't have gone out again. Stephen, the Mediterranean was once the biggest dry lake in the world, in the late Miocene era. Alan, the water came rushing in over the Strait of Gibraltar. Stephen, you're quite right, 6 million years ago. Alan, I know this because I saw it in the Plymouth Aquarium. Jimmy Carr, that must have been fabulous for all the towns around Spain and Portugal that rely on tourism. When that came in, they went, this is fantastic. Finally, these jet skis are going to get an outing. Which birds inspired Darwin's theory of evolution? Many smart people would answer finches, but actually it was mockingbirds. The great passion of the young Charles Darwin, 1809 to 82, was killing wildlife. As a student at Cambridge, when the shooting season started, his hands shook so much with excitement he could hardly load his gun. Though studying medicine and divinity to please his father, he dismissed lectures as cold, breakfastless hours, listening to discourses on the properties of rhubarb. But he was also an enthusiastic amateur biologist and fossil hunter and was keen to see the tropics, so he signed on as a gentleman naturalist for HMS Beagle's second survey expedition, 1831-6. He almost didn't get the job. The captain was keen on physiognomy and thought that Darwin's nose indicated laziness. Charles later noted that, "I think he was afterwards well satisfied that my nose had spoken falsely." The story goes that during the voyage, Darwin noticed that finches on different islands in the Galapagos had distinctive beaks, which led him to guess that each type had adapted for a specific habitat and evolved from a common ancestor. It's true that Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection originated aboard the Beagle, but it had nothing to do with finches. Though Darwin did collect finch specimens from the Galapagos, he showed very little interest in them until years later. He was no ornithologist in those days and wasn't even aware that the finches were of different species. It wouldn't have helped much if he had been because he didn't label them to show where they'd been caught. He mentioned them only in passing in his journals, and they are not mentioned once in On the Origin of Species, 1859. The mockingbirds were a different matter. Intrigued by the variations between the populations on two nearby islands, Darwin took careful note of every mockingbird he encountered. Gradually, as his journals show, he began to realize that species were not immutable. They could change over time. Out of that insight, all his subsequent theories on evolution grew. Because the finches are a perfect example of Darwin's theories in action, later scientists assumed that they must have been the birds that inspired him. One of these was the evolutionary biologist David Lack, 1910-73, whose 1947 book, Darwin's Finches, fixed the idea and the term in the popular consciousness. Darwin's book on the voyage of the Beagle was an immediate bestseller, and the trip made the captain's name too. Robert Fitzroy, 1805-65, went on to become a vice admiral, governor general of New Zealand, and the inventor of weather forecasting. One of the sea areas in the shipping forecast is named after him. The finches got famous too. As we know, the 15 species of Geospitzini are still popularly known today as Darwin's finches, although it turns out they're not finches at all, but a different kind of bird called a tanager. Where's the most convenient place to discover a new species? In your own back garden. You can cancel that expensive and possibly dangerous trip up the Amazon. In 1972, an ecologist called Jennifer Owen started to note down all the wildlife in her garden in Humberston, a suburb of Leicester. After 15 years, she wrote a book about it. She had counted 422 species of plant and 1,757 species of animal, including 533 species of parasitic ichneumon wasp. 15 of these had never been recorded in Britain, and 4 were completely new to science. Suburban gardens cover 433,000 hectares, well over a million acres, of England and Wales. If so many new species can be found in just one of them, this must be true of others. Between 2000 and 2007, the Biodiversity in Urban Gardens in Sheffield Project, BUGS, repeated Dr. Owen's work on a bigger scale. Domestic gardens account for some 23% of urban Sheffield, including 25,000 ponds, 45,000 nest boxes, 50,000 compost heaps, and 360,000 trees. These present, as Professor Kevin Gaston, BUGS's chief investigator, put it, 175,000 separate conservation opportunities. One of BUGS's discoveries was what may be a new, minuscule species of lichen found in the moss on an ordinary tarmac path. To more or less guarantee discovering a new species, all you need is a garden, a lot of time and patience, and a lot of expertise. In the words of the 18th century naturalist Gilbert White, 1720-93, in zoology as it is in botany, all nature is so full that that district produces the greatest variety which is the most examined. In 2010, London's Natural History Museum found a new species of insect in its own garden. They are baffled by what it is, as it doesn't match any of the more than 28 million specimens inside the museum itself. Part of the fun of discovering a new species is that you get the chance to choose what it's called. A recently discovered beetle with legs resembling overdeveloped human biceps was called Agra schwarzeneggeri. A fossilized trilobite with an hourglass-shaped shell was called Narasaphus monroeae, after Marilyn Monroe, and Orectoculus orbisonorum is a whirligig beetle dedicated to singer Roy Orbison because it looks like it's wearing a tuxedo. In 1982, Ferdinando Boiero, now a professor at Lecce University in Italy, but then a researcher at Genoa, had a more underhand motive in naming the jellyfish he discovered Fialela Zappei. It was a cunning plan to persuade his hero, Frank Zappa, to meet him. It worked. They remained friends for the rest of the musician's life. British-born astrobiologist Paul Davies of Arizona State University urges us all to search for new unknown forms of life. It could be right in front of our noses, or even in our noses, he says. The one thing you don't want to find in your nose is an ichneumon wasp. These unpleasant insects caused Darwin to lose his religious faith. I cannot persuade myself, he wrote, that a beneficent and omnipotent God would have designedly created the ichneumonidae with the express intention of their feeding within the living bodies of caterpillars. What kind of bird is Puffinus puffinus? Before you answer, bear in mind that Ratus ratus is a rat, Gerbilus gerbilus is a gerbil, Aureolus aureolus is an oriole, Iguana iguana is an iguana, Conger conger is a conger eel, and Gorilla 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 is emphatically a gorilla. And Puffinus puffinus? Bad luck. That's the Manx shearwater. It's unrelated to the puffin. Scientific names for animals are usually composed of two words. The genus comes first, followed by the species. The species of a living thing is defined as that group with which it can reproduce. Its genus is analogous to its tribe, a group of species that are clearly related to each other. When the names of an animal's genus and its species are the same, that's called a tautonym, from the Greek tautos, same, and onoma, name. For example, the bogefish is bups bups, and mops mops is the Malayan free-tailed bat. Where there is a third part to the name of a species, it is used to indicate a subspecies. So the triple tautonym gorilla gorilla gorilla, the western lowland gorilla, is a subspecies of gorilla gorilla, the western gorilla. The tiger beetle subspecies megacephala, 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 has a name that translates as big head, big head, big head. Sometimes a subgenus is also given in brackets, such as bison, 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 which, for the avoidance of doubt, is a kind of bison. Tautonyms for animals are not uncommon, but are strictly forbidden for plants under the International Code of Botanical Nomenclature. There are three species of puffin, and they belong to the genus Fratacula, Latin for little brother, because their plumage resembles monastic robes. There are about 30 species of shearwater, all of which share the genus name Puffinus, which comes from an Anglo-Norman word meaning fatling. This refers to the chubbiness of the young birds and hints at their culinary uses. They were eaten both fresh and pickled and, because they swim so well underwater, were for a long time thought to be half fish, which allowed Catholics to eat them on Fridays and during Lent. Shearwater chicks were easily mistaken for puffins, which probably explains the confusion over the name. Puffins, and particularly their hearts, are a national delicacy in Iceland. The oldest living bird ever recorded in Britain was a Manx shearwater. It was found by chance in 2002 by the staff of the Bird Observatory on Bardsey Island in North Wales. They were delighted to discover that ornithologists had ringed it in 1957 when it must already have been at least 5 years old. It's reckoned to have covered around 8 million kilometres, 5 million miles, over more than half a century, flying to South America in the winter and back again to Britain for the Puffinus puffinus breeding season. Jeremy Clarkson, you don't want to listen to this, but I once had some whale, and they said to me, would you like me to grate some puffin on that? Can you name three species of British mouse? 2 points each for harvest mouse, house mouse, field mouse, and wood mouse, and 4 points for yellow-necked mouse, but -10 for dormouse. The dormouse is more of a squirrel than a mouse. Admittedly, it does look rather mouse-like, except for its tail, which is furry. Mice have scaly tails. It also has fur inside its ears, which mice don't. In fact, the dormouse is generally furrier all round. This to keep it warm in winter. It's the only British rodent that hibernates. The dorm part of its name means sleepy, and sleeping is what it's best at. The golden-coloured common or hazel dormouse can spend 3/4 of its life asleep. It's also known as the seven sleeper because it regularly spends 7 months of the year dormant, though warmer winters now mean its hibernation lasts 5.5 weeks, less than it did 20 years ago. If you want to get involved with dormice, you'll need to go on a dormouse handling course and apply for a government dormouse licence. The British dormouse population has fallen by 70% in the last quarter century, and it is now strictly illegal to disturb, let alone kill, this rarely seen nocturnal creature. The much larger edible.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.